valves are failure surgery and emergencies. This is a ventricular septal rupture post MI. That's the rupture of the septum LV2, which we had an opportunity to handle recently. We handle the entire gamut of valvular heart disease. We handle a lot of aortic root enlargements, and we also do minimally invasive surgeries. So mitral valve replaced through a small incision, aortic valve. We do a lot of, I had the opportunity to do a lot of homografts for aortic valve replacement, which we found was much better than bioprosthetic valves and mechanical heart valves. That's previous valve, Star Edwards valve, which we had to replace with the homograft. So coming to heart failure, I'm sure you all know that, you know, we were involved in one of the, this is the first pediatric heart transplant in the country. We looked at a few ECMOs and we were involved in some ECMOs devices as well. So coming to the main part of the talk, this will be on the timing of surgery in congenital heart disease. Congenital heart disease, just as a quick primer, you all know that it has got two types. One is acyanotic, cyanotic. When you have acyanotic, it's predominantly a left to right shunt or it's a stenotic lesion. If it's cyanotic, you have either a mixing of blood or a decreased pulmonary blood. It's all defined by the quantum of pulmonary blood. So the common asynotic congenital lesions include ASD, VSD, PDA. Obstructive lesions include partition of aorta, aortic stenosis, and pulmonary stenosis. Cyanotic diseases, the commonest ones are the 5 T's, as we say, the transfusion of great arteries, truncus arteriosus, tetralogy of TAPVC, and tricuspid atresia. Other ones are pulmonary atresia, liver, VSD, DS, Epstein's, and AMI. These are also quite the timing of surgery in congenital heart disease greatly determined by the quantum of pulmonary blood flow and pulmonary vascular disease. If you have a high pulmonary blood flow with high pressure for a long time, they develop irreversible changes in their pulmonary vasculature. After that, you cannot do a complete repair. And the type of surgery at any one point is defined by the system, you know, whether we can do a repair at that point or you can palliate and then repair, all that is also different. So, Eisenmenger's is something that we see very infrequently at this point, sometimes when we do a camp, maybe in the periphery. I think the last one I had seen was in Udupote, where we had done a camp 2 years back, some Eisenmenger's. Not all that frequent, but still happens in a country where people don't come to the hospital or are denied by our society of appropriate health care. You know? So, coming to the asynotic lesions, the commonest ones are the VSDs, the second would be the ASDs. ASDs, if they are asymptomatic and if the shunt is more than 1.7, then we do the ASD is closed between 2 and 4 years. Before they go to school, the lesion is taken care of. But 10% are symptomatic in infancy, 10% develop early pulmonary arterial hypertension. So if they do present in infancy, we try to rule out some other concomitant, you know, malformations there. Otherwise, you know, if they present in infancy, usually we tend to operate in that. China's, you know, so if you just a reminder, the 4 types of ASDs, this is the commonest, the second one type. Then we have what is called as a sinus venosa ASD, which can be IVC type or SVC type. And we have a coronary sinus type and the primum type of ASD. So sinus venosa ASD, again, preschool we operate. So the commonest way it's done is today with a device. And the second ASD is quite amenable to a device because it sits like a button there. The other types of ASDs usually surgeries, and very infrequently we have extracted devices because a very large device was put in and it started eroding the aorta kind of. So we do quite a few minimally invasive ASDs, this is a 5.5 cm incision below the scapula, right scapula, and the child probably never gets to see the incision at all, and that's a big social. VSDs, again, the management depends on the location of the VSD, size of the VSD, and the physiology involved. When you have a large VSD, then they present with failure pretty early, infancy, 4 months, 5 months. And they kind of isomerize by the time they are like 1 year, very severe pulmonary arterial extension. It's a very small VSD, they don't cause it. It's the malady, Roger, where the murmur is bigger than the problem. And sometimes the location of the VSD is also a problem. If it's right beneath the AV valves, then they can, by injury effect or lack of support, they can cause regurgitation of the AV valves, particularly in the subaortic location. So spontaneous closure is pretty rare. Smaller VSDs with muscular margins have spontaneous closure. Smaller VSDs, we tell them, only one thing is infectious and endocarditis prophylaxis. 1 to 2% chances of infectious endocarditis, and that's the only thing we want the family about. Tell them to take care of the oral hygiene and the oral hygiene, and any discharge and die, any fever. So this is an infective endocarditis of the tricuspid valve. That's the vegetation of the tricuspid valve which we had to resect and repair. So VSDs, large VSDs, they present with failure by 3 to 4 months. If it's uncontrolled failure, we operate even earlier. Moderate size VSDs, operate preschool. If there is repeated LRTA, then you operate earlier. If it's very small VSD, then it's only infectious in the endocarditis prophylaxis. If there is aortic valve collapse or AR, then we intervene at that time. So coming to atrial ventricular septal defect, that's the defect in the formation of the AV valves and the atrial septum and the ventricular septum, the intracardiac motion defect. It's not something uncommon. This is a partial defect, this is a complete defect. In partial defect, we have a predominant primum AST and maybe a cleft and mitral valve. Sometimes they have regurg, otherwise it's usually competent. In complete AV septal defect, we have a primum AST, inlet AST, and a common AV valve. So this presents pretty much like a large AST. We control failure, and in 3 to 6 months, they have surgery. Partial AVST is treated much like regular AST, and surgery is pretty smooth. Coaptation depends on the pulmonary, whether it's prostate dependent or if it's prostate dependent, they need surgery in the neonatal period. Otherwise, we can wait till LV dysfunction or congestive failure or pulmonary ischemia, etc. Coming to aortic stenosis, we have valvar, subvalvar and supravalvar, and the grading process is 64 mm. That's when we operate in. But in subvalvar AS, the jet can sometimes hit the aortic valve, and the aortic valve can get regurgitated. In that case, they need a resection at an earlier stage. So coming to the commonest cyanotic lesion, there's a tetralogy of valve. I'm sure you don't have to take it through all that. It's hypertrophic ventricle, obstruction to the pulmonary pathway, overriding aorta, and a large VSD. That's the hypoplastic pulmonary artery, and the entire RV in the ventriculum is small. So what we do is like we close the VSD and resect the RV to make sure that the pulmonary pathway is good. So this is the pathway to the lung. RVOT is opened up and we close the VSD. So we do reconstruct the pulmonary valve. We have to cut across the annulus with the monocusp PTFE valve. Coming to the timing of surgery, tetralogy of fallow. If they have saturation, this number is one number that probably everyone should. Anything less than 75 is not good. Anything more 80 and above, we are happy. So 70 and below, not really happy. We need to intervene. The child is too small, less than 6 months, we do a shunt. If it's more than 6 months to 1 year, we do a complete repair. But between 1 and 2 would be a better time. Depends on the institutional policy. Anybody over 8 kilos, we are comfortable doing that. This is a rare complication of tetralogy where we had a perforation of the aortic valve. We had to repair that. This is another rare complication of tetralogy where the ascending aorta was aneurysm. In one of the proximal arches, we had to do a repair of the tetralogy with the ventral operation, replace aortic valve up to the proximal arch, replant the denominator. So this is the BT shunt that I said, where we augment the pulmonary blood flow. A connection is made between the base of the denominator, the right subclavian, and the right pulmonary artery. Described by a cardiologist, done by the surgeon. Ductal stenting is another thing that comes, like where the ductus is stented open with the stent, and pretty much achieves what a BT shunt can do, that you increase the pulmonary blood flow. Not very commonly done, but we do it in cases with pulmonary ADSA, VSD, PDA, where multiple procedures are planned. So at least we avoid one surgery with the ductal stent. This is again the worst end of tetralogy, where the entire RV outflow pulmonary artery is so diminutive that we have to are we to be conformity with our conduit? This is a homography. We have other conduits as well. So conduit options, we have different conduits. This is a homograph, this is a valve conduit, this is a Bowen jugular. This is a conduit with PTFE that we suture in the theater. So all materials they degenerate over time. This is calcification of a homograph. So 8 to 10 years down the line, we end up replacing them. This is not something unusual. This is an absent pulmonary valve. This is an aorta, RA, RV, absent pulmonary valve, dilated pulmonary arteries. So we have done an RV to PA connection with the conduit and repair. So later they, you know, undergo degeneration. This is a LV, RV stenosis conduit that degenerated, calcified. We end up replacing this conduit that we have to replace with a homograph. So increasingly all these valves, we cut off the pulmonary valve, it tends to leak. By the time nephrology patients come back, particularly they had a transaminal patch across their pulmonary arteries. By the age of 20-22, they need the RV starts dilating. Then we need a pulmonary valve. Either we do a pulmonary valve implantation or increasingly this percutaneous valve is coming. And we implant a valve in the pulmonary position. This pulmonary atresia VST, no connection between the RV and the PA. This is a valvular pulmonary atresia, decent size branch PA. It's a ductus feeding. This is a type which may be amenable to a ductal stenting initially. Later, you know, we can do a. This is the worst kind of pulmonary atresia where there is no connection between the lungs and the heart. When all the pulmonary arteries are supplied, all the lobes are supplied by major aortopulmonary collapses from the descending aorta. So this is the pulmonary atresia VSD with a PDA. So this is one case that we had the opportunity to do. Like this is a conduit that we used to reconstruct the RVPA continuum. Point there. So this is the worst end, like you have multiple small collapses from the descending aorta going to both the right side and left side. I mean, transposition of great arteries, you know, if it's intact IVS or with VSD. If it's intact IVS, we tend to operate it in the second week of life. If it's with a VSD, it's usually in the second month of life. We do an arteriovenous operation. So 2 to 3 months is fine. Like you do as you just swap. The RV gives rise to the aorta and the LV gives rise to the PA. You swap it and relocate the coronary. Anomalous pulmonary venous connection is instead of connecting to the LA, all the pulmonary veins join here, it goes up and comes through the, you know, SVC ultimately, or it can be a cardiac, or it can go down to the total vein or the IVC and then come down from the say, intracardiac type. Then you have a mixed type. So if they present with obstruction, it's a neonatal emergency. Otherwise, we tend to operate it a little later, like 8 months to 10 months. So obstructed is an emergent surgery. In the unobstructed, we operate at the rest. Truncus arteriosus is where you have a single trunk coming out instead of an RV to PA and LV to aorta. You have a single truncal artery that overrides the VSD and then it gives rise to the pulmonary artery. Here we detach this, close the VSD and then put an RV to PA conduit. So these are our, this is a conduit in the truncus where you know, we have connected the RV to the pulmonary artery using a conduit. So this is a conduit that we use. The single ventricle is another big area and it's a challenge. And sadly, most of the single ventricles are aborted. No longer all the antenatal scans pick them up and most are aborted. Here we have only one good ventricle that can take care and the other ventricle is small. When the other ventricle is small, the pulmonary arteries, the SVC and IVC are connected directly to the lungs. And it doesn't have a ventricle to pump. And the good ventricle which is there is used to pump into the systemic circulation. So here you have a hypoplastic RV. This ventricle is pumping into the aorta. And then there is a VSD and a small connection to the pulmonary artery. A different variants of the single ventricle. So what we do here is detach the SVC, connect it to the right pulmonary artery, detach the IVC, connected to the right pulmonary artery. So without the heart, the blood flows directly into the lungs and gets oxygenated, comes back to the airway, and then that's pumped by the single ventricle into the aorta. So sometimes when the single ventricle has excess of pulmonary blood flow, we know what is called as a PA band. We restrict the flow as a first stage. This subset of patients have multiple stages of surgery. The SVC part, what we call as bidirectional gland, is done earlier. The Fontan completion is between 4 and 8 years. And this is like if they present with excessive flow in the neonate, then we do a PA band. This is a Norwood for a hypoplastic left heart. We are done. So after this, we'll have to do the SVC part, and then we'll have to do the IVC part. So it's like multiple surgeries. But we have the LV morphology. The ventricle, single ventricle, can be an LV type, RV type, and indeterminate type. It's an LV type, they do pretty well. In fact, we have a guy who is studying in Surat, in medical college. We have an engineering, Hassan Roser, and Vani Badi. On the whole, they do well till their second, third decades. After that, probably they'll need, the ventricle starts failing and starts going wrong. So, this is something what we call as a DKS anastomosis. And then this is the Glenn SVC. Okay, thank you. I think I would like to leave you with this. I think we all have lost focus of ourselves. We are in some crazy game where we think all problems, heart attack and heart disease, comes to the next person. I think we should get out more often, do what we enjoy, at least try to do 150 minutes of exercise a week and stay healthy. Thank you.
Thank you.